What do you think about having bugs in your code? You know that old joke, it's scary when you see them, it's scarier when you don't. So how can you tell that your code has no bugs? When we design microservices, for example, we use service contracts. I will now show you how you can use contracts on your regular classes too. The idea is not new, it is the design by contract technique. It has been around for a couple of decades already, and it dismisses the possibility of making certain kinds of bugs in classes and methods. This is the application where I will demonstrate the use of design by contract in C#. C# doesn't support design by contract. It only has a very limited support for it, you will see. But that doesn't abolish you from knowing it and applying it as part of your design process. I'm doing that all the time, and I will now show you that secret. This is just an interface, and it is exposing a method. Well, that method alone comes with an implicit contract, so to say. The contract consists of three parts: preconditions, invariants, and postconditions. For example, what are the preconditions, the prerequisites to calling this method? It requires a non-null price object and a non-null context object. You don't have to get into the details of this interface. This is the interface declaring a discount. The important part when talking about contracts is that both items must be non-null, otherwise the implementation of this interface could not guarantee to produce the result. Now, when I said that there is a limited support for design by contract in C#, this is the example. C# now is testing non-nullable references. That is an example of design by contract. Unfortunately, C# is not going much further than that. Preconditions could go much further than this. For example, we might request an amount of money which is greater than something. That's not part of this interface. This interface doesn't make such a request. Now, postconditions. Postconditions are the opposite. Postconditions are the promises made by the method. Whatever side effects it promises, those must be explicit. Whatever attributes of the returned object it promises, that must be made explicit. Again, nulls, the most trivial of all postconditions. And the invariants, those are the promises made by the object that they will always be satisfied by that object. If you get a collection which is sorted, for example, it promises to be sorted. So no matter what you added or removed from it, collection will be sorted whenever you touch it. Now, you already see that invariants depend on the state. There won't be any invariants here, but you should know that there is the place for invariants as well. Now, why is the contract so important? It is important because of the caller. Look, this is the place where that getDiscountAmounts method is invoked. It is part of a much larger and much more complicated process. And so, for this larger operation to be correct, this operation has requirements towards that method it is invoking. And then what are the post conditions I require here? I want a guarantee that there will be no zero discounts in that list, in that sequence I'm receiving. Also, I don't want to get embarrassed. I request the sum of all discounts to be strictly non-greater than the book's price. So these are the post conditions I require. And who do I require it from? Here, that getDiscounts method, it belongs to another interface. We have post conditions that must be promised by the result, the iDiscount object returned, the concrete object returned from this method. So let's say that this interface method will only return objects that satisfy a more rigid requirements, post conditions. Whatever it returns, it cannot produce zero amounts from its getDiscountAmounts method. Another post condition is that the sum of amounts produced by the result cannot exceed the input price. If we get back to the iDiscount interface, you will see that none of these additional requirements is promised by it. So who is going to promise that? The concrete implementations. Isn't that the list of substitution principle? Yes, it is. And here is one concrete implementation of that iDiscount interface. It is the relative discount, which is multiplying a price with a factor. This is the place where we'll look for stronger post conditions, more restrictive post conditions. Look, this class is validating the factor. It must be strictly greater than 0 and strictly less than 1. It is tempting to say that this class is promising to never return a zero amount. Well, not true. There is no precondition that the price will be greater than 0. However, we can promise that the sum of items, there will only be one item, will always be smaller than the input price. That no items will be 0 on the output. How can we promise that? Well, we turn to another class. Non-zero amounts discount. It will delegate to another discount. This implementation will ask that other discount for the discounted amounts, but then it will remove any zero values that might happen to be in the sequence. The post condition promised by this object, this class, is that it returns only the items with amounts greater than 0. But then we are always forwarding the call to the other discount. Therefore, any preconditions of the other discount we are wrapping become the preconditions of this method too. But then what about post conditions? We are overriding the post conditions, and some post conditions will still hold. For example, if there is the post condition that the sum is less or equal to the price, that post condition is retained in this method, do you see? If the wrapped object is already promising it, it's quite dynamic as you see. And if you asked why C# doesn't support such a beautiful technique, this is one of the reasons. It is so freaking complicated. And if you liked the video so far, this is the moment for you to press the like button. Thank you. Let's move on. Let's see what are the consequences of having this class. Here, this is the demo implementation of that iDiscount server. It is inheriting the entire contract. Both post conditions must be satisfied by this concrete implementation. As I said, this is the demo implementation. In a realistic software, we would probably deserialize this object from somewhere. Don't think about the value of that parameter because it would change. And whatever the value it is, we must promise that the price will not be exceeded and that it will never return any zero values. Well, that is where design by contract comes to table, because we can add post conditions, make the object stricter by wrapping it inside another object which adds promises to it. Now we have both guarantees. The relative discount will promise to never exceed the price, and the non-zero amounts will promise to never allow a zero on the output. Both post conditions are now set. You can download the source code from my Patreon page if you're interested to read. There are many classes here, and you can analyze them and think about their preconditions and post conditions and see how they are playing dynamically at runtime. It is a very interesting topic. So visit me on Patreon. There is the link to my Patreon page in the pinned comment and in the description, and see the source code there. Now, what if we wanted to apply two discounts? Well, things are becoming more complicated that way. There is a special composite implementation in this codebase. You can learn about the composite design pattern if you like. There is a video which I have already prepared with this same example. Parallel discounts implementation will apply two discounts to the same input price and concatenate their results. But we have just lost one post condition now. Because this book author discount, it doesn't promise to never return zero, the same way as that relative discount doesn't promise that. Also, they are executed in isolation, and so the sum of their results could easily be greater than the price. I have just ruined both promises made by that structure I had. How do I reinstitute them back? One thing could be to move that non-zero amounts discount at the very top, so to let the parallel discounts concatenate whatever these two discounts said, and then purge any zero discounts from the resulting sequence. Now we have that promise to never return a zero discount again. But now it's very important for you to understand how this structure of objects is constructed. You see, these objects would be deserialized from some JSON or whatever document, and then, before the deserialized object graph is applied, we must wrap it into the objects that will add guarantees to that object graph. And so, we have just added the post condition that there will be no zeros. But how do we guarantee that the sum of discounts will not be greater than the price? We prepare another specialized decorator. You can also learn about decorators from another video I made. This one here, it's very complicated. It is adding a guarantee that the discounts, all the discounts applied, never exceed the price. That is what its name is saying. And that is the post condition it adds to whatever discount it wraps. It is a proper decorator object. But now if we get back, we can just apply that one around the structure we are protecting. And now there will be both post conditions promised again. Again and again, C# has no support for this. Not many languages have, and not in the fullest extent, as you have seen. There's the static part of design by contract. You could create some Boolean tests that can be verified during testing and even during the runtime. And even the compiler can perform static code analysis for us and tell us if we are open to a certain kind of a bug. My conclusion, design by contract is hard. The good news is that you can make them your own habit. You can think in terms of contracts while designing classes. You have seen how it works. I hope you learned something valuable from this demo. Thank you for staying till the end and see you in the next episode.